class. Welcome to the next segment in Lecture 19. And in this segment, we're going to talk a little bit about identifying fronts, which kind of stems back from something we talked about in Segment 1, some of the additional characteristics of fronts, that is, change in weather, wind shift, locally lower pressure. That's where we're going to actually start taking some of those characteristics and applying those to, say, a real-world situation. So that's going to be the main topic for this segment, how to take some of those characteristics and use that idea, use that information to identify fronts on a weather map. Typically, when you're looking for a front, given, say, a plot of observations or even a plot of model data, what you typically look for is you look for a region of strong temperature gradients, and to some extent, you might also look for a region of strong moisture gradients, because for some fronts, like cold fronts, you typically have cold, dry air that's separated by, or that separates, or where you have a separation of cold, dry air from warm, moist air. Let's put it like that. So for a cold front, it might also make sense to look at the moisture gradients as well as the temperature gradients if you're looking for a cold front. But typically, what you want to focus on is the contrast in temperature. That's typically what you look for when you're identifying fronts. But you can also identify fronts. Again, this goes back to the characteristics from segment one, by looking at the isobars, by looking for a region of locally lower pressure, by also looking at the wind pattern. If you've got a wind shift, then that would also indicate the presence of a front. And also just a difference in weather. Again, that's a difference in weather we mean by having an unsettled pattern versus a relatively stable pattern, or even to some extent clear skies versus cloudy and rainy skies. So let's take a look at the first technique that we might use. So identifying fronts from a thermal gradient. And you can see we have a pretty pronounced thermal gradient here. So the temperatures are primarily in the 70s ahead of the front and behind the front. Yeah, no thank you. Actually, this is a 336-hour forecast. I don't think this even actually came through as it was expected. But the temperature gradient was so ridiculous enough that I figured it would be useful to use for, say, educational purposes. So I decided to save it. So again, really, really sharp temperature gradient evident here. And typically when you go to draw the front based on the thermal gradient, you put the front right at the very edge of the leading edge of the thermal gradient. So right around in here where the mouse cursor is moving, right where that warm air, right at the point where the warm air becomes colder air, that's typically where we would draw the front. In this case, it's most likely a cold front. And again, the triangles point in the direction that the front is moving. So our front would probably look something like this, right at the interface of the warm air and the cold air. And we can also identify fronts, believe it or not, by taking a look at the surface pressure map. So here we have a very intense cyclone over central Canada. And if you take a look at this very carefully, you can see how you have this, what looks like a nice dip in the pressure levels in the isobars. You can see how the isobars look like they're going straight and then they dip. And you can see that on a lot of these isobars, there's a region of, what that tells us is there's a region of locally lower pressure in here, then that would imply the presence of a front. And if you draw a line connecting the center of all those dips in pressure, you would get, say, a frontal boundary that looks something like this. And in all likelihood, this is probably a cold front. And then up here, this is also probably a warm front as well, because you can see there's sort of a pressure dip that goes something like this as well. So there's probably this is probably a massive occluded cyclone that's over central Canada, but you can also draw a front just based on the pressure map. Again, right at the interface, or right in the center of the front, is where you've got a region of locally lower pressure because you've got strong upward motions. And you can also identify a front by just looking where those locally lower pressures are and just connecting a line, drawing a line to connect all those dips in the pressure. So again, you can look at isobars to also identify where a front might be at the surface. This doesn't work so well when you go into the upper atmosphere, where the temperature gradients are usually weaker, but at the surface, this does often work pretty well. And of course, you can also take a look at the wind field to identify the front. And one dead giveaway that this is probably an intense cold front is you have this really strong northerly flow and also a monstrous anti-cyclone over the Dakotas here. This is a 1060 millibar high, which is definitely on the higher end of high pressures. You don't see high pressure systems like this very often. But you see, as we have this strong northerly flow, and at some point over the Gulf, it becomes more southerly. And so that would imply that somewhere in here we've got some sort of cold front happening where we've got northerly flow becoming more southerly flow. That would imply that we've got colder air meeting warmer air, which would tend to indicate that there is some sort of cold front present here. And you could probably also make the case that there's some sort of front present over here where you've got northwesterly flow meeting westerly and then easterly flow. So there's probably also some sort of frontal boundary present there. But again, this is just an example of using wind shift to sort of pinpoint where a front might be located. This doesn't work all the time. Sometimes you can have a wind shift that occurs well ahead of the front, which is termed a prefrontal wind shift. But for most fronts, I'd say most fronts, this technique does work pretty well. And of course, using the differences in weather. So again, stable pattern versus unstable pattern. Here you can see we have a massive line of cloudiness and unsettled weather occurring over the Atlantic and to some extent the Northeast. And then you have clear skies in the wake of that. So that would tend to indicate that there's some sort of frontal boundary separating a stable air mass from an unstable one. And this also does not work every time. In fact, this is probably the least reliable method because, especially on a severe weather day, you can have clear skies where the air is both unstable and stable. So this doesn't work very well for that. But if you've got a really intense cold front kicking up a lot of showers and thunderstorms, then you could potentially use this to identify where that front is located. But most reliable method is either the isobar method or the temperature gradient method, looking where that temperature gradient occurs, that strong temperature gradient occurs, and also looking where those isobars dip. They have a relatively low pressure at some point, and that point marks where the front is. But that's going to do it for this segment on identifying fronts. And we still have one more segment left, and in that final segment, we will get into the mathematics of fronts. So that had to happen eventually, so yay for that, and I will see you all there.